Santa Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Golden Sequence, A Manual for Reclaiming Our Humanity by Jonni Pollard, narrated by Jonni Pollard. For my wife Carla and daughter Safira Devi, our love defines me. Introduction. From my earliest memories growing up in Sydney, Australia, I was really happy and uncomplicated. I loved life. My mum says that I had enough energy to power 3 full-grown humans. Get down from there now was the constant chorus of my childhood. I was incapable of walking in a straight line and would spontaneously gravitate to the highest and scariest thing in my path to jump off. I felt safe and secure in belonging to my family. Then when I was 7, my parents divorced. It rocked me to my core. Something seemed to split deep inside of me. I loved both my parents, equally, as a unit. When they separated, my feelings became deeply complicated. It felt like my security and belonging to my family had been torn away and replaced by a cloud of anxiety and confusion. After the divorce, I began to feel like an outsider in the world, despite a deep desire to belong to it. My sister and I spent most of our time at our neighbor's house, while my mum worked 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. as a solicitor each day, which only added to my increasing anxiety and a sense that I didn't belong anywhere. School was like fuel to the fire of my anxiety. I went to a Catholic primary school just across the road from my house. At an early age, I developed a deep fascination with the Bible and with the teachings of Jesus, which at their core reflected the way I felt about life. I loved learning about how important it was to care for one another, to love and forgive. I remember finding a great deal of comfort and relief in these classes. Religious studies was my favorite subject, and I would always top my class every year. Despite my obvious passion for the subject, as Anglicans attending a Catholic school, although my family was not religious, it was a tradition that we were all christened within the Church of England. My sister and I were never fully acknowledged or embraced. We were excluded from the most significant religious events and ceremonies in humiliating ways. This made me feel ashamed about who I was and unworthy of belonging, and being rejected like this caused me a great deal of hurt and conflict. Jesus was all about unconditional love and about including people who were discriminated against. No one could properly explain to me why we had to be excluded from what appeared to be the most important parts of connecting with his teachings. Over time, my anger at being rejected grew into cynicism. I felt like the only way I could feel okay about myself was to reject those people in return. Through my rejection, I discovered a kind of power and the freedom to be myself. I stopped trying to make sense of the hypocrisy around me or to fit in, and began to do my own thing. All I wanted was to ride my skateboard and paint on stuff. And the more I did my own thing, the more I stood out. I began to realize there was something very different about me, but didn't know what it was or why. My teachers and other adults would bombard me with their propaganda of fear designed to convince us kids to conform to their program, a program that everyone else seemed okay with, get high grades or fail in life. Do everything you're told, or something terrible will happen to you. The relentlessness of these attempts at rigid control of the way we thought, behaved, and related to ourselves, and the heightened sense of anxiety and worry they relied on, felt manipulative and uncaring to me. I slowly began fortifying myself through my continued rejection of anything that attempted to impose its rules on me. By the time I was 16, I realized that there was so much more to life than what I'd been told. I knew I didn't want my life to be what the people around me told me it should be like. I just hadn't quite worked out what I wanted it to be instead. It was around this time that I made a sincere commitment to only ever do what felt good to me, regardless of the warnings of others. After a few big conversations with my parents, despite them both, as academics, having walked very traditional career paths, they accepted that I was going to live life on my own terms. They knew it was going to be an uphill battle to try and get me to conform, and so they became a tremendous force of encouragement for everything I threw myself into. something that I have since come to see as a great act of wisdom and the greatest gift they have given me besides life itself. Because of some seriously good fortune, or karma, depending on your worldview, and the relentless mindset of living by my creed of only doing what I loved, I managed to make a decent living as a professional inline skater, doing touring shows around the world, and as a lead in a hit TV series, Heartbreak High, that ended up being broadcast in over 80 countries. I also had a beautiful group of friends who were deeply connected to one another through our desire to live life on our terms. Although mildly seduced by society's praise and my apparent success, I began to acknowledge a deep dissatisfaction within myself. Something big and important was missing. The anxiety of my younger years started to bubble to the surface again and began dominating my thoughts. My buoyant teenage rebellion was growing weary under the weight of the old and familiar ache to belong like I did as a child and to have deeper meaning and purpose in my life. To everyone's dismay, I quit the TV show, just as it was peaking in popularity, and pulled off the skating circuit to dedicate my life to truly understanding how I could reconcile this conflict inside me. I made the commitment to do nothing but sit still with myself for as long as I could bear, with the hope that some clarity would arise. To my surprise, it didn't take long for insight to emerge. I began to realize how much energy I was investing in rejecting the things I despised about the world, when really all I wanted was to be a part of it, contribute to it, and have an impact on it in a meaningful way. This revelation was bittersweet. In some moments, I felt a deep love for life that was familiar. I could see the indescribable beauty of humanity's existence and the extraordinary potential in our humanity to experience something so much greater than what we currently are. In those moments, anything felt possible. And in other moments, I experienced irrational eruptions of deep pain and sadness. Despite my desire to be a part of the world and love myself and others unconditionally, I was increasingly becoming aware of an elusive shadow of anxiety, fear, and mistrust in me. I began noticing how I mistrusted my own lovability and my power to contribute anything of real value to the world. I noticed more and more where I was judgmental of myself and others, how I was being overcome by these tendencies, despite my best intentions. Why was this happening? What was the source of this negative, pessimistic reaction to life? Why couldn't I remain connected to that deeper feeling of love and live life from that place? The more aware I became of this happening in me, the more conflicted I felt. The lack of control I had over my thoughts and feelings began to chip away at my confidence. I felt like such an imposter. One minute, I would have potent feelings of benevolence toward the whole world, and then the next, I would rip someone to pieces with my ruthless inner critic. It was an extremely vulnerable time for me. I remember huge outbursts of uncontrollable emotions. I would swing from feeling overwhelmed with worthlessness and unworthiness to feeling extraordinary love, power, and possibility. I resolved to understand the root of this terrible affliction of my inner world that was causing me so much suffering. I needed to understand why I could feel so much love and so much disdain at the same time. I was driven by an intuitive sense that I could somehow free myself from the clutches of my destructive, defensive, cynical mind and dwell in this highest state of love. I remember sitting on my couch for days and even weeks on end, just sitting and observing everything that was happening, in the hopes that I might be able to understand how my heart and mind worked and how I could get them to agree for more than 30 seconds at a time. In these early stages of doing nothing but being with myself, I was often confronted with the arduous task of distinguishing the real me from that elusive shadow. But after some time, I began to notice that if I stopped trying to have an opinion about what was happening and just accepted, listening and feeling deeply into my heart, amid the pain I was feeling, a wave of calm, still connectedness would wash over me. When I was able to simply be accepting of the moment and not judge myself, this calm would remain steady and constant for longer periods. In this connected state, I was flooded with overwhelming feelings of love for life and the knowingness of my lovability and worthiness and my responsibility to contribute to the world. In these precious moments, the shadow of my conditioned beliefs that I was unlovable, unworthy of belonging, and had nothing of value to contribute became like debris floating on the surface of a vastly deep ocean. And within this feeling of love was a powerful sense of purpose to live in a way that always nurtured my connection to it. The feeling of being completely free of the trap of needing to identify myself based on who I wasn't rather than who I was started to last longer and longer. For the first time since I was a kid, I felt like I was able to be who I truly was, regardless of what the world thought of me. I came to realize that rejecting the status quo had been my way of defensively finding my place in the world. I could see that the weariness I was feeling was the buildup of accumulated pain and anxiety of living in a world that felt disconnected from the fundamental human experience of feeling love and our need to nurture it as the most sacred experience we can have. But these beautiful and powerful anxiety-free moments were still irregular and always left me yearning for more. Would I have to sit on the couch my whole life to get these little breakthroughs? Or was there a way of making this my permanent state? I was filled with determination to discover how. I knew I needed help to get better at this. The big question was, who could I ask? No one I knew at the time could really relate to anything I was experiencing. Was there someone out there who was an expert at this? Around this time, I was introduced to a very special woman who seemed to have a deep understanding of what I was experiencing. There was something different about her when she looked at me. I felt like she was seeing the person I was trying to become. She suggested that I travel to India to visit her teacher, whom she had visited every year for the past 25 years. He was recognized as a great master. I remember asking, "Master of what?" She responded that he had mastered the steady and stable experience of unconditional love. She said there were many masters like him in India. I felt relieved and I was utterly intrigued that people could be known and celebrated specifically for their mastery of love and that they spent their time teaching it. Being defined this way made so much sense to me. Just the notion of becoming a master of love began to fill a gaping hole I'd been filling most of my life. 5 days later, I was on a plane to India. I'll admit that I was totally lured by a romantic notion that this guru would recognize me as some kind of special case and take me in to teach me the ways of the universe, like Yoda did for Luke Skywalker in the Star Wars trilogy. I imagine him insisting that I stay in India and just meditate next to him day and night until he made me enlightened. Needless to say, the story didn't play out the way I expected. However, my new friend was right. Her teacher delivered the goods and in a far more practical way than croaking, "Do or do not, there is no try." He revealed a profoundly beautiful way of seeing life that, based on everything I was already experiencing, made so much sense to me. He explained that on our path through the world, life will present us with opportunities to discover why we are here and how to live in deep connection with this purpose. In every moment, we have a choice to embrace life, free ourselves of fear, and allow love to reign in our hearts and dictate our lives, or to deny life's call to belong to its sacredness, remain disconnected, and continue suffering. Eventually, life ensures that we do evolve, whether we like it or not. When I quit my job, I did so because I hadn't felt like I had any other choice but to actively pursue a greater understanding of who I truly am. That feeling of choicelessness was just an indication that I had been resisting nature's call for too long and that now it was time to answer. What fascinated me was that everything I had been experiencing since my unscheduled sabbatical, this wise master described as being a very normal and natural process of awakening. My story was just like that of countless people before who had also reached a point of no longer being able to ignore a deeper truth within of who they were and how they must live to honor this truth of their nature. My master would often use that word, nature, in his discourses, and then always tie it back to the tradition of knowledge he was a part of, the Vedic tradition. The Vedic tradition. The Vedic tradition comes from India and is the source of the practices of yoga and meditation. The Vedic perspective of reality states that our existence is governed by an unlimited creative intelligence that pervades all levels of our physical and non-physical universe as one whole unified reality. Everything in the universe belongs to this unending web of creation spanning into infinity. Interestingly, the modern quantum mechanical theory is in agreement with this ancient perspective about the nature of the universe. This creative intelligence is dynamically expressed in recognizable patterns and cycles that we call the laws of nature. These laws work in symphony to ensure balance and evolution on every level of creation. The Vedic worldview is that humanity is entwined in this unending web of life and is also governed by these same laws in nature. When we're connected to this creative intelligence within us, we feel it as a deep sense of sacredness of life and as a knowingness of our belonging to it. We experience this intelligence as our intuition. The ability to know something without the need for intellectual reasoning. When we allow the impulses of our intuition to flow, we become the agency of greater balance and evolution within ourselves and everyone we encounter. When we are disconnected from this deep intelligence, we feel disconnected from who we truly are and confused about our relationships with others and the world. This ignorance of our belonging to the sacredness of life is recognized as the root of suffering. What blocks our connection to our intuitive intelligence, Vedic teachers say, is simply our lack of awareness that we have an intuition. The word Vedic comes from the word Ved, which translates to knowing. The Vedic tradition is dedicated to knowing our deepest nature, not only on a conceptual intellectual level, but also as an embodied experience. That is to say, knowing through direct experience how to bring the greatest balance and growth to our lives. When my friend's teacher first laid everything out to me like this, I was completely captivated and so relieved that many before me had already worked all of this out. At last, I had a framework to begin making sense of my experiences, along with simple practices that would enliven in me a sense of power to live life with profound meaning. And so my long and intense romance with myself, the present moment, and India began. Since then, I've spent a lot of time in India and in other parts of the world to study this ancient knowledge. I've had the privilege of learning from some truly remarkable masters, both in the East and the West. Under their guidance, I've studied with great passion and dedication to become a teacher of this ancient knowledge. The traditional lineage in which I've trained is of great masters known as Maharishis. A rishi is a seer or knower of reality, and Maha means great. A Maharishi is a great knower of reality, who has mastered living an unshakable state of harmony with all of nature and is dedicated to teaching others to become Maharishis. My teachers are Maharishis, and it is to them that I owe my ability to share with you the knowledge in this book. The other term used to describe the role of a Maharishi, which you are no doubt familiar with, is Guru. It's a Sanskrit word that means remover of ignorance. Gu means darkness or ignorance. Ru means remover. In the tradition that I teach, the function of a guru is to remove the habit of ignoring the underlying sacredness of belonging to all life, so that we may become self-sufficient in awakening and actualizing our deepest purpose in life and fulfill it. Traditionally, a guru is considered more of a function than a person. A guru makes her or himself available to shed light on reality whenever a student seeks to remove the habit of ignoring it. Like many great things imported from the East to the West, the term guru has become bastardized and convoluted. There are tech gurus, sales gurus, social media gurus, which cracks me up. When it comes to spiritual gurus, the term often carries a stigma that conjures up all kinds of icky reactions in people. Those reactions are not without good reason. There have been many who, parading as gurus, have taken advantage of people's vulnerability and desperation for guidance and leadership. Pretend gurus have exploited their students' sincere desire to connect to a deeper truth and utilize this powerful yearning in their followers to fund their own personal gain. But a true guru is someone dedicated to the service of humanity's advancement. And to carry on the legacy of my teachers, I also aspire to be of service to humanity here in the Golden Sequence as I share with you the very teachings that changed my life. My personal mission. It has been my deepest purpose for many years to make the profound knowledge of the Vedic tradition accessible and easily understood for everyone. The reality is that very few have the resources or time to dedicate their lives to the process in the same way I have. Realizing this, I have spent many years translating the vastness of the knowledge I have gained into simple, practical teachings. The most foundational of these teachings, the one that this book builds to, and from which the book takes its name, I call the Golden Sequence. The Golden Sequence teaching, when practiced diligently, rapidly awakens the creative intelligence that flows from within us when we're connected to the sacredness of life. Through the experience of this highest intelligence, we can become masterful at dissolving fear as it arises in our lives and, despite all of life's challenges, remain steady in our ability to respond from love. This teaching is the product of years of teaching people from all walks of life who, like me, were no longer willing to tolerate the weight of suffering and who desired a simple process to learn how to transform their suffering into lasting fulfillment. The Golden Sequence isn't about thinking positive. It's not about how to manifest your dreams. It's not even a belief system. It is a practical methodology to use when you become lost or trapped in suffering, defensiveness, and fear. There's a tendency of seekers of knowledge in the West to buy spiritual self-help or personal development books, read them in a few days, get a real high from them, and then put them on the shelf and eagerly await the next. But gathering lots of knowledge without putting it into practice can be more of a hindrance to personal development than a help. When we understand something on an intellectual level, but do not put it into practice, we become susceptible to the delusion that we fully understand it. And then, despite getting it, our experience doesn't necessarily change in the ways we're expecting it to. This is because knowledge is designed to be put into action, to dissolve old habits and to establish new ones that support our ever-increasing well-being. Learning and practicing this teaching is not just about gaining an intellectual understanding. It's about exploring and experimenting how to apply new knowledge to your day-to-day life to bring greater balance and growth, and therefore, deeper fulfillment. Accordingly, this book aims to make what can sometimes be complex concepts not only very easy to understand, but also practical to integrate into your daily life. The most important point of the process of learning the Golden Sequence is to understand that it is a practice. I want to show you how to form the habit of taking full responsibility for your personal experience in order to reclaim the power to drive growth in your life. In the sequencing of this knowledge, I will reveal how to practice it and when to practice it. The exercises I will set out for you are both simple and achievable. The emphasis of your practice should be on the process rather than the specific outcomes. Any practice of establishing new habits is a creative process of learning new skills, and so, for our practice to be successful, we must be patient and process-orientated. We are all wonderful works in progress. You are more than likely going to forget what you learned in the heat of certain moments. This is the very nature of establishing new habits. You forget your new habits and fall back into the old. The process of remembering and forgetting is very natural. The key thing to remember when you realize you've fallen into old ways is to stop, dust yourself off, and reflect on what you've learned, then begin again to reintroduce the new habit. When we take this approach, the concept of failure falls by the wayside. By simply being committed to the practice, there is only learning, growing, and empowerment. Now, for some of you, all of this may seem obvious. It is very important, however, to be constantly reminded. The power of negative self-talk can often infiltrate our learning process. When it does, we can judge ourselves as being stuck. That reinforces old habits of thinking and feeling worthless, self-doubting, self-loathing, and hopeless. When we accept that forgetting new habits is a natural part of learning, we start the practice of self-love, compassion, and nurturing. We immediately break the cycle of self-criticism. There is another very important reason to remain process-orientated rather than goal-orientated. As a teacher, time and time again, I see students become disillusioned by their rigid attachment to ideas of what change is supposed to look like, caught in rigid attachment to the expectation for a specific outcome. Often, the ideas we have about what resolution looks like are very different from a resolution that will truly free us of fear, attachment, and defensiveness. Most of the time, the ideas we have about resolution are actually very much a part of the same defensive strategies that we're trying to free ourselves from. When our attention is devoted to the process instead, what we discover is that the process itself becomes the resolution. As I reveal the teaching in this book, I'm going to introduce a series of concepts and insights about the nature of our humanity that serve as building blocks for understanding how to practice the golden sequence technique. I'm going to define the meaning of certain words I will regularly use to ensure you know exactly what I mean when I use them. These include love, wisdom, fear, defensiveness, empowerment, and sacredness. Remember, this knowledge is structured sequentially. Resist the urge to skip forward to get to the juicy bits. Deep knowledge without correct sequencing is like having a recipe that's missing important steps or ingredients. A recipe missing one critical ingredient or step is bound to be unsuccessful. Only through familiarization of the complete sequence of knowledge and good old-fashioned consistent practice can we really expect results. This book encapsulates the essence of the ancient Vedic teachings in a format that relates to every human being, regardless of cultural, social, religious, economic, or political orientation. It serves as a manual for anyone seeking to understand our deepest human nature, why we struggle to trust it, and how we can reclaim the power of it to overcome the greatest challenges we face both personally and socially. It confronts head-on the beliefs and ideologies that trap us in the delusion of powerlessness and disconnection from ourselves, each other, and our natural world. At the heart of this book, and of the golden sequence technique, is that only through embodying the power of our intuitive intelligence, which I call love, and learning to allow it to flow through us continuously in every moment, regardless of where we are and who we are interacting with, are we capable of being truly empowered and fulfilled? The golden sequence is a complete recipe and practice for reclaiming our power and fulfilling our deepest sense of purpose. When we commit ourselves to it, it is profound. But as I've mentioned, just reading this book isn't going to elevate you very much. It would be silly to spend hours preparing a delicious meal and serving it up only to walk away without tasting it. If you're going to take the time to prepare the meal, please give yourself the time to indulge and savor the deliciousness. Be truly nourished. Put this stuff into practice and discover your power to create deep, lasting transformation in your life and in the lives of everyone around you. Chapter 1: The Heart of Our Crisis. Our world is in a precarious state. We are witnessing today humanitarian, environmental, and social crises that stem from the ever-increasing dehumanization in our rapidly changing world. By dehumanization, I mean the reckless compromise or straight-up ignoring of what we as humans need to be well and flourish as a species in harmony with our natural world, all in the name of profit and greed. And although this cauldron has been bubbling for a while, now it really feels like it's about to hit a boiling point, spill over the edge, and make a big old mess. The signals of crisis are clear as day. Violent regime changes, raging wars, and the displacement of millions of people, crashing economies, corrupt governments and corporations, environmental depletion and the degradation of vast natural lands and resources, mass rallies and protests all over the world, not to mention the global mental health crisis. It can feel like we are hopelessly sitting on the sideline watching it all unfold. This, in my opinion, is the greatest misconception of humanity. This book sets out to make a powerful case for humanity's innate power to affect change in the world through our instinct to love. Connecting with this instinct is the most powerful and important response possible to our current human crisis, a crisis we all play a role in and carry equal responsibility to address, because the primary problems we face on Earth right now are human-created. If you feel a desire to significantly contribute to our world's challenges, you must first reclaim your power to overcome fear and learn to embody the deeper truth of your humanity. The Golden Sequence technique is a practical way of cultivating our power to become the change we individually and collectively need right now. It teaches us, step by step, how to let go of our conditioned defenses and connect with the deeper power of love and wisdom that is always inside us. Only then will we have the intelligence and confidence to reinvent the way we live to cultivate greater connection, growth, and belonging, the key ingredients for lasting fulfillment. In my teaching practice, before students can connect with their deeper nature of love in a stable way and experience lasting fulfillment, they must confront the reality of their suffering, hold themselves accountable for their part in it, and be willing to move into it in order to move beyond it. When we learn to surrender into our suffering and accept our feelings, the suffering ceases, and what we are left with is less pain and deep insight about how to free ourselves of our pain completely. Only by recognizing what traps us in suffering can we free ourselves from it. At the core of this crisis is a socially ingrained ignorance and denial of the immense responsibility we have for each other, the earth, and ourselves, and our power to contribute to the world in a way that sustainably supports the good of all. In Western society and culture, we're more connected to each other than ever through social media and mobile communication, and yet we feel increasingly disconnected and isolated. Even though we have all this wonderful technology and software to automate and streamline so many things that used to take days and even months to accomplish, we are working harder and longer than ever before. We are more stressed, exhausted, and overwhelmed than ever. Stress-related anxiety, depression, and ill health are rampant. Our capacity to adapt to the relentless demand to keep up is rapidly waning, as the demand has a radically negative impact on our bodies and minds. We are witnessing a mass stress-induced burnout of our nervous systems, immune systems, and overall cognitive function. The struggle that this pressure of life creates has so distorted our perspective of reality that we struggle to find real connection and meaning in and for our lives. To add to this already very challenging situation, we are drowning in marketing, whose sorcery of deception leads us to believe that we aren't enough as we are and that we must have things we don't need. We are coerced through divisiveness into dangerously extreme polarities and entrenched in blame and victimhood. And we have become stuck in the belief that the world's big problems are all too big and too hard to do anything about. We are so completely overwhelmed by the pressure of modern living, so preoccupied just with coping, that we often feel incapable of doing anything about any of the problems we see, even in our personal lives. This state is commonly referred to as survival mode. Survival mode is our automatic biological response to a threat to our lives, an acute stress response often referred to as fight or flight. On a biological level, the pressure of our environment tells us we're in danger and we need to be constantly on guard. Being on guard means living defensively rather than.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.